Hello everyone, welcome back to our conference, the Triple Nexus in Practice. I'm very delighted to now introduce to you the so-called Spotlight Sessions, so a format that is very dear to us. In the discussion on the Triple Nexus, there are certain aspects that always come into play and are never really thoroughly discussed. This is why we came up with this specific format, the so-called Spotlight Sessions, that I'm going to briefly introduce to you. We will first start with a session on protection issues that Florian Westphal is going to facilitate in conversation with Marc Dubois. After that, we will focus on civil-military coordination, a session that I myself will facilitate with Mena Abraha from RCF Spain. And we will finally close with a session on German donor instruments facilitated by Julia Stets of GPPI, and she's going to talk with Rüdiger Schöch from Plan International. I would now like to introduce Florian Westphal to the stage, and he's going to take over from here.
Thank you very much, Andrea. Thank you. And before I start and introduce myself and Mark a little bit more, just a few housekeeping rules, because even on Zoom we have housekeeping rules. So please, everyone, do turn off your camera and your microphone. And please, everyone, post your questions in the chat function. So towards the end of the Spotlight session, we'll have a moment, quite a long moment, actually, to really focus on some of these questions. So we're really looking forward to that. And then if you have any sort of technical problems, you need some troubleshooting, please write a private message in Zoom to the user CHA Technical Support. That's C-H-A Technical Support. So my name is Florian Westphal. I'm currently working for the Global Public Policy Institute here in Berlin on a project which deals with protection, and specifically the impact of protection activities and how these activities are being seen and considered and perceived by armed actors. And we'll be looking in particular at Iraq for that part of the study. I'm also a former general director of MSF Germany, so Doctors Without Borders here in Germany, and previously worked for the ICRC, the International Committee of the Red Cross. And I'm really pleased to sort of welcome from Berlin to London, you know, sitting there at his home office. I know he'd love to be here in Kreuzberg with us. Marc Dubois, who is an independent humanitarian analyst and consultant based in London. He's also a senior fellow in the Department of Development at SOAS, the School of Oriental and African Studies, University of London, and you have hopefully already read his contribution to the CHA blog recently, where he talks about the Nexus, and it really illustrates the focus of his work, I think, which is quite a critical examination of humanitarian policy and practice, and in particular of what Marc sees as the very siloed way in which humanitarians tend to see the world, and in particular tend to see those communities that they say they're working for. Prior to becoming independent, Marc actually also spent quite a bit of time with MSF, most recently as the executive director of MSF Doctors Without Borders in the UK. Please do check him out on his website, humanicontrarian.com, and also on Twitter, where he's a lively contributor. So Marc, I just want to take you back a little bit to get us started to the article you wrote for the CHA blog. And one thing I really enjoyed and found intriguing and interesting is that basically you called on humanitarians to engage in something you called nexus thinking. And I think you really made a lot of that notion of nexus thinking. Now, in general, but maybe if you can already a little bit referring also to protection in particular, so to work that aims to enhance the protection of civilians at war or civilians who may be discriminated against or marginalized. What could nexus thinking look like, and what's going on wrong now?
Well, good afternoon, everyone, and good morning or good evening if you're somewhere else in the world. And thank you very much to CHA for this opportunity. I've been wanting to talk about, I've been really wanting to take these very ideas like nexus thinking and apply it to humanitarian protection. In my earlier years, before I was general director here in the UK for MSF, I was working in humanitarian protection. So just basically, maybe to recap very simply, what I looked at when I started thinking about the triple nexus is that first, look, the problem is not the linkages between the silos. I think more linkages between the silos would be a good thing, but I don't think that's not solving the problem. The problem is the silos themselves, because reality isn't siloed. And we heard that this morning from a number of the participants in the first panel, that look, the needs on the ground are intermingled, and we come and apply these sort of siloed tunnels of vision in a way in which the aid we deliver, but I also think in a way in which we think about the needs and the solutions to those needs. A second thing I really think is that it's through Nexus thinking that we can really imagine a different way of operationalizing the principle of humanity, and one that pays much more attention to in humanitarian circles to human dignity. And I think that's where you start to get very close to protection, because in some ways a very broad definition of humanitarian protection might be, you know, taking aim, calling attention, paying attention to, you know, sort of harmful exercise of power that denigrates human dignity. That's violence, discrimination, and other forms of dignity-stripping sort of behavior. And what does that mean? And how do we try and protect people in that situation? And Nexus thinking, I think, is simply that if you're inside the humanitarian sector, and you and I were both really deep inside it in MSF, you really don't see the world very clearly. I mean, this morning I was really impressed with just how clearly the call was for context analysis, right? And what you realize is that if you're inside the humanitarian sector, you're not. It's almost like malpractice in context analysis, because you're seeing it through such a narrow lens, in particular when you're looking at conflict. And so, just, you know, I look at Nexus thinking not as a new way of thinking, but a less artificial way of thinking and a less inaccurate way of thinking that maybe gets us to, you know, imagining what humanitarian protection would look like through a peace lens or a conflict resolution lens or something like that, and through a development lens. And I think in both of those areas, you're talking, I think at the first place you're talking about the power of humanitarians. That's where I would look first with those kinds of lenses, because we are a powerful actor in these societies that has an impact on people's dignity, and we tend to dismiss that when we look at our actions through a very short-term humanitarian lens.
Okay, thanks. Let's break that up a little bit and go one step a little bit deeper. And what struck me is when we chatted last week to prepare for this session, we noticed actually that both of us, you know, having been active in the humanitarian sphere for probably longer than you'd care to admit to, actually know very little, for example, about peace building. We know very little about efforts, especially at the community level, in the very same countries and societies that we've been dealing with, what happens in that respect. So these kinds of blind spots that humanitarians have maybe give us a bit more of an idea of where they could be regarding protection, and also maybe where humanitarians should be looking in the other two pillars of the Nexus.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree more, Florian. I mean, although the word blind spot's a funny one for me here. I thought, because think of what a blind spot is. You're driving down a road, and a blind spot is that little space right in back of your car, right? And you're still right there, and you can't quite see it in your rearview mirrors. And it's a very generous term to apply to what really is, actually, we're driving with our eyes closed right down a road with a lot of people, because we are humanitarians, and I'm particularly thinking about working in protracted crisis situations caused by conflict, are driving, are a major, major pillar of what's going on in that area. The amount of aid, you know, if you think of a place like Eastern Congo and South Sudan and those kinds of contexts where we are a very, very important part of the entire context, and we rarely even see ourselves as part of that context. And it's very clear just from listening to Martina and Felipe and Marta from South Sudan, just listening to them this morning about how much we miss in terms of our understanding of peace and conflict, right? And just that idea of, well, what does it look like through a big P versus a little P lens for peace? And I think that that's where you really start to worry that we're driving a pretty big bus through, and we've got blind spots in front of us, and in other words, blind to the harm we might be causing when for instance, I think often we would just oversimplifying in humanitarian aid. We want to make sure our aid doesn't, in a very direct way, help one party over another, right? We want to avoid that the aid we deliver doesn't contribute to the conflict dynamics. But it's a very superficial level that's really applied only at that level of geopolitical conflicts, big P. But what would it mean if we started thinking about it at a much smaller level? And I think that's quite problematic. And I think the development lens is a similar lens. Development is about empowerment. And I think when you look at humanitarian action through a very short-term lens, I think what you're looking at is the fact that the power of dealing with immediate needs trumps the sort of the underlying and long-term needs and aspirations of people for livelihoods and development and peace and stability. And that makes sense in 3 months, 6 months, 1 year of an emergency. But how does it make sense over 20 years? Right, that continual or perpetual triumph of the urgent over the important, of the immediate, of reaching immediate needs and addressing immediate needs over what are the declared aspirations of people for development and stability and livelihoods and jobs and employment and not to be dependent and things like that. And I think that's where you start unpacking a little bit, these blind spots, because it's a very serious blind spot. If we analyze, for instance, the impact of humanitarian action through the short-term lens in which it's designed to have its impact.
But let's sort of try and apply this a little bit to the more concrete scenario. You mentioned South Sudan. You mentioned Democratic Republic of the Congo, and I want to add, that for me, my impression is very often, I think that typically the description that is given of a context where humanitarian protection happens is exactly that of a situation where there's no real development happening, there's no real prospect of development happening either, and peace, as desirable as it is, and as much as everyone wants it, is a dream sort of far off on the horizon. So at the end of the day, though, what alternatives are there to actually prioritizing the urgent over the important and the short term over the long term?
Yeah, no, I think you've given a great example of how the power of our narrative to define that context. And I think the first place I would go if I were working in humanitarian protection is to look at the narrative. And in particular, I'm thinking, it's a very reductionist approach to humanitarian protection, but that standing up in the world and pointing your finger at certain places in the world and certain governments and actors and saying, you guys are bad, right? And it typically is guys, so I'll be a bit sexist there. You guys are bad. And that's a pretty incredible act of power. And in particular, the way in which it reinforces and becomes part of a very biased, one could even say, racialized version of world events, a narrative that is, there are countries that are like this, they're just violent ethnic strife, and it is the damage done, and the damage done to development by that narrative that would be, for me, the first place to look if I started to think, how do I protect people from humanitarian protection? Right? From humanitarian action more globally, but then humanitarian protection. Because one of the other key messages this morning in that first panel wasn't just, you have to get your context analysis right. And running blind isn't a very good way to do that. And second, you have to get your own house in order. And you have to get your own house in order before, I think, in humanitarian protection, before you start pointing your finger at other people's houses. And I think that's where development thinking, the lens of development, also comes in, because development's essentially about empowerment. And it's empowerment of people in crisis or people in poverty and destitution and structural problems, where you would empower them against the forces having power over their lives. And I would think that development work would be very welcome if it empowered people. I don't want to say the word against humanitarian action, but against those bad aspects of humanitarian action, right? Where what you're looking at is the way in which we don't, we don't have accountability to people. We haven't really talked to them about their needs and worked together with them on their needs, so that the way in which over time it becomes disempowering.
Let me stick with that theme of empowerment, but maybe sure. just move it a little bit again towards this sort of protection idea and this notion of really being able to influence the behavior of armed actors, whether that's state armies, international military forces, or any kind of rebel or militia group. What's the role and what's the potential of actually both the affected communities, obviously, and of also local actors when it comes to trying to actually design and implement those kind of protection activities? I mean, in the literature, and I've just started reading a little bit of academic stuff about protection, that is one of the most frequent criticism that is made of humanitarian, but also other protection actors, is that they systematically tend to undervalue, underanalyze, and simply not take seriously enough those two actors, the affected communities themselves, obviously, and the local organizations that are closest to them.
Yeah, I mean, I think you use the term undervalue and underanalyze, and I think that's right. Often for a simple lack of contact, right? Again, if you're operating within the silo of a major international agency, one of the criticisms has been over decades now, the lack of interaction, the lack of that dialogue. I think a second aspect to that, though, is not simply to undervalue, but simply the humanitarian construct involves, the idea that people are helpless, right? It is essentially this is our how we fundraise. We have to save people because they are helpless. We have to intervene. This extraordinary act of going across an ocean to intervene because people are helpless. And I think that whether we articulate that or not, it undermines exactly the kind of conversation you would think you would want to have. A second is, if you look outside of our circle, for instance, if you look at nonviolent peace activists, they talk about people power. They don't talk about, international finger pointing power. They talk about people power and what it really means. And if you look at, for instance, even recent events that we would remember, for instance, the fall of the Mubarak regime, that was people power. And those are the kinds of people that international agencies feel, no, we need to stand up and we need to act. And I think the second part of this equation is we need, I think, as a sector to understand that we occupy a space, right? We have enormous it has been well-built access, well-developed access to the halls of power, the places where you can have influence. We are sitting at the table. We are occupying chairs, and we have very well-resourced communications departments to put out our message. But all of that occupies a space into which the message of those actors might come. So that when you think about, in a stereotypical, and I think a wrongly stereotypical fashion, about local NGOs and their abilities, I think what you would say is, well, they don't really have the ability to influence things on the international level the way we do. And that's probably true today, but it's true because we have occupied that space, and we occupy it very aggressively, because that's our that's our business, that's our livelihood, and that's what we want to do. But I wonder, at another level, especially when you start thinking about working in a context, living in a context, and being connected to that context, how the advantages and the opportunities that are there, if only there was a space in which that weren't so powerfully occupied by the humanitarian sector. I think I'd stop there.
So we're going to get Darina over here in a moment, who's got some questions from the chat. But I just want to ask you one more quick question while she's getting ready to bring that here, which sure. is really, and picking up the last thing you said, not because I particularly believe in it, but just to be the devil's advocate a little bit, because I suppose that's a bit my role. So how feasible, though, is it in concrete terms to expect a local NGO, say in Eastern Congo, to confront the Mai Mai sort of traditional militia group that controls its territories with concrete accusations of sexual violence being committed against the women in these communities? I mean, is that, beyond the fact that, that's how the role of local actors should be, but is that a feasible sort of proposition? Under what circumstances is that feasible?
Yeah, I don't know the answer to that. I think two things come to mind, though. One is, it's a good question, but maybe it's the wrong question. I mean, you know, built into that question is a very Western-based understanding of what protection means. It means to go and confront people in a way that is calling for an end to impunity and for justice processes to take place and things like that. And, you know, there are other models to arriving at justice, even things like restorative justice, and that aren't so based in what I would call, and I think this is where the conflict resolution lens comes in. A lot of what I used to do in humanity, you know, the reports I used to write, you could say they were exercises in othering, in pointing a finger and creating a division and a divisiveness, not contributing to bringing communities together and resolving conflict, but actually to drawing a line right in the middle of it and creating divisiveness and pushing and creating sides. Them, they're bad, they're evil, and I'm not trying to say that what the Mai Mai does is somehow acceptable, right? But I think there's a way in which there are other approaches, and I would think that civil society actors, I would look to Lucha, a really interesting civil society actor in the Democratic Republic of Congo, to think and ask that question to them, because I think they can do a lot. For one, if we get out of the way, and for two, because they're looking to communicate in a different way than the way we communicate. We're communicating for our audiences. And I don't think that confronting the Mai Mai with their actions would necessarily be the way that a local actor would do it. And I think that's probably a good thing.
Okay, thanks, Mark. So talking about audiences, as you just mentioned them, we have an audience this afternoon, obviously, and I hope that audience has been sending us their questions through the chat. So Darina, what do we have?
Thank you very much. And yes, we did have a very lively audience, also online. It was a pleasure listening to the two of you, but I'd like to introduce two questions in a row, if I may, to make it easier for you to prioritize and to make the best of the time we have. So the first question, set of questions I would like to introduce is about the humanitarian principles. We've been talking about that today in the morning as well. A user called Felix N refers back to one of the graphs that we were showing today in the morning, actually, where we showed that 63% of the humanitarian actors are actually seeing the risk that Triple Nexus compromises the humanitarian principles. So with this in mind, how can the humanitarian principles be maintained with the Triple Nexus? Andrew asks Mark, are there actually inherent contradictions between activities facilitating peace and the humanitarian principles designed to allow actors to work in conflict? So this is the first set, and the second set is around power issues. A question posed by Tem Rizekan, I hope I pronounced that correctly, apologies for any pronunciation mistakes. So he is asking, or that person is asking, do you think the Nexus thinking may be also manipulated by global humanitarian agencies to continue to assert their power over human conflict? So a bit of a provocative question, and with that I'd hand back over to you.
Thank you very much. And I think those are two nice, big, juicy ones. But Mark, I'll let you go first, maybe on the things related to the humanitarian principles, and maybe give it a go. I think it should be possible to relate the two.
Yep.
Actually.
Yes. Yes. No. I do think that at a certain level, especially if you start thinking about the nexus in terms of coordinated action, a joining up of forces, for instance, in a place like Mali, a joining up of peacekeeping, development, and humanitarian action. I do believe that there's a contradiction in certain contexts that would be at the level of the. You might say the technical application of humanitarian action. You know, just what are humanitarians doing? And in a certain location, it could be, you know, very difficult for your access, for instance, if people don't view you as neutral and independent, for instance, in a given context. So I think Andrew's right to assert that. I think the problem is maybe a bit too much of a knee-jerk reaction from humanitarians that only assert that. And not understanding that there is a harm in doing that, right? And there's a harm in humanitarian action that continues for year after year after year, and then decade after decade, without really venturing outside of that kind of a, well, there's a contradiction, we can't do it. And I think that goes back to that survey, the question. 63% of actors see a risk to caused by the triple nexus on the humanitarian principles. And I think that's fascinating, because the problem with that is the blind spot. The blind spot is that there is a risk to the humanitarian principles of humanitarian action. That's the problem. The problem is the impact of humanitarian action on dignity, on human dignity. In other words, on the principle of humanity, that is the top principle, the purpose of humanitarian action. And so I do think that, of course, the sector needs to be mindful of the way in which it impacts upon neutrality and independence, that it might be getting tangled up. And again, remember, I'm not talking about doing development or doing peace for humanitarians. I'm talking about thinking through a different lens and interacting with people, cross-pollinating our conversations and analysis of a situation to the point where we're not so siloed. But the point at the center of that, though, is that we need to do something about the fact that humanity, which is a substantive ethical principle, not a means to an end. Neutrality and independence are means to humanity. And so if we have to compromise neutrality and independence in order to improve our humanity, I'd say that's not a bad thing. At least it's a thing we should be deliberating rather than simply dismissing. And it's because of the blind spot, we just assume our humanity. Oh, we're good. We're delivering aid to people. Therefore, we are achieving that goal in terms of humanity and not understanding, Marta Takahuira, and I'm sorry, Marta, I'm sure I've just mispronounced your name, but, talked about dependency syndrome. And what does that do to your human dignity to receive, just to get a handout for 20 years? And we have to confront those things, because we are giving that handout. And we can't just blame it on the context and nobody else is there, and the usual way of blaming it on others.
Okay, we're on the home straight. Thanks very much.
Okay.
I just want to add to that as well, that I think that for many humanitarians, especially the view of neutrality and independence is far too dogmatic. Humanitarians, especially those active in situations of war and armed conflict, compromise on these principles all the time, very often for access, sometimes for other reasons too. It's not always made very explicit that that's the case. So before we wrap up, just 1 minute, Mark, on
the
this
power
thing.
Question.
I like that other question about are the humanitarians sort of manipulating the triple nexus to stay safe? That's my own addition now to the question.
I think it would be impossible to believe they are not manipulating it, right? These are controlled narratives. The way in which humanitarian action maintains such a high level of power and legitimacy has a lot to do with its manipulation and control of the narrative. And it takes a lot of power to do that. And it is the way in which the power of that sector, which is largely, and I'm thinking about the formal Western-based, Western-funded sector, which is only one part of it, but it's a powerful part of it. It is a very strange bedfellow for some, but it is, sorry about that. It is a bedfellow with, the soft power of the Western hegemonic thinking, if I were sitting around in SOAS and having that debate.
So you have roughly 1 minute to tell us one thing you really want to tell us, which I haven't asked you for yet, and then I have to wrap it up. And if you could combine that with a sort of notion of a way forward, it's a recommendation or something we ought to think about and pay more attention to.
Well, I wish I could do that in 1 minute. read the paper. No, look,
yeah,
I
read think, the paper's fine. I think look, I agree with you.
I think in some ways the whole idea comes back to, if you break out of your silo and start really having other people inside your organizations as humanitarians, and you're inside their organizations, and you realize, wait a second, what we are doing delivered a lot of good in the world, and that's great, but that's not all it's doing. And to understand that it's doing some things that have negative consequences, and they can be mitigated if you're aware of them and saw them. And you know what? If they can't be, maybe they can't be mitigated, then you can make deliberate choices, but they should be deliberate. And third, and most importantly, humility. Because what the humanitarian sector needs more than anything else is to get off its own planet, out of its silo, and learn some humility. And I think it helps if you interact with others, let alone listening to people in the countries where we work, listening to local NGOs and others. All of that can help humility. And the last thing I'll say is, you know, we always ask about local NGOs. They've been doing the triple nexus. They are the triple nexus, if not the quadruple and quintuple nexus, right? And it's we are going down as humanitarians and trying to capacity build them into a silo. And I think that's the last thing I will say. That sounds like a good place to end. Stop reproducing the siloed, you know, unworkable, you know, sort of sector in the rest of the world through an exercise of power that is that is completely based on an asymmetric power dynamic.
Thank you very much, Mark. There's nothing much I want to add. I think it's really exciting to hear about your different perspective on the Nexus, which is not about structural arrangements between different coordinating bodies, but which is genuinely about a new way of thinking, breaking the boundaries between us. And with that, yeah, thanks very much for me too. And I hand you back to Andrea.
Thank you, Florian, and thank you, Mark, for the very interesting discussion. We will resume in about 1 minute to continue our session with a hands-on talk on civil-military coordination under triple nexus conditions with Mena Seged Abraha from RCF. See you in a minute.